Okay, we are doing an interesting one today. We're going to make a custom button that can move. So it's not just a block or just a thing. You can make just a block or just a thing that interacts or does something when you interact with it. But we're actually going to make this big, huge button here that when we interact with it, it moves and makes a noise. So let's get on with it. Pretty cool, right? All right. Okay, so we are inside of UEFN and there's a few things to do to make this happen. First thing we need is a button. So if we go down into the content browser and go into devices and then search out button, we can bring in a button. Now I've done a video on the conditional button. This isn't what we're looking for, that does something else. We just want a basic button. And this button is, it can be used for a lot of things. You can use buttons for a heck of a lot of stuff, but it's mainly an interaction device. So in screen, something that somebody can see, but this button is not, it's not interesting. It blinks, I think, when you click it, like the light blinks a little bit, but I want to make something that, you know, really moves. Look at the size of this thing. I mean, it's a nice, big, huge button that we can do something with. So the first thing to do is get a button onto the screen. And the button has this really cool attribute down in the details panel. And it allows you to put in a custom mesh. So that's really neat. So I have custom mesh inside of my project already. So I'm going to show you how to do that. Okay, I'm inside of Blender now. Now, if you've never used Blender or a 3D program, I highly advise you to get started with doing it. It's very, very, very useful. So I've got two parts to my button. This is very, very important. A couple things to think about. Now, I didn't make this button. I actually got this button from my plugin here that goes and searches for stuff from a particular site. But what I have done is separated out. We need to separate out the moving parts. So there's this part, so we'll move this out of the way and you can see, and then there's the button part. So there's the body part and the button part. When you do make a button, I'm not going to make a button because it'd be a waste of time. It's not a modeling tutorial. When you do make a button, there's a couple of things to think about when you're going to export it. So we'll move this guy back. And what we want to do is I'm going to hit 3 to go to side view. And that's going to tell me where I've put this button. So I might move it just a little bit more here because we want the pivot point to be, well, you want it to be wherever you want it to be. I like mine in my bottom left corner. So if I go to front view or back view, which one have I gone to? Either way, it's going to be this corner. I'm in front view right now. So this is going to be the bottom left of the front of the object as I see it. So this is the front of the object. I just happen to have it backwards on the screen. But the point is that it's the front of the object, the bottom left. So if I hit Control 1, then I'm going to get the back view. And then I can just move this just slightly over. So ideally, I'd want it to be just a little bit over, very close to where the X, Y, and Z come together. You can see here, right? So but not just that, we also want the other object to be very close to that zero point where we think that the center of it is. So if we just move over here or just hit 1, we can see that the center of this object, and we'll hide this one, the center of this object is pretty much in the center there. And the point of where it's going to touch something is right on the X or just a little bit off it. It should be right. It doesn't have to be perfect, but bear with me. Get it as close as you can, because otherwise when you bring it into UEFN, it's going to have this weird pivot point that you're going to hate. So get that right. All right. So Alt-H to bring back the other item. And the other thing that I want to note, and we'll go take a look at this in UEFN, is that if your mesh is too thin, doesn't have enough sort of volume to it, like this bit here, it doesn't actually show up properly. So I wanted to show that. The knob part, the part that is the actual button, was like that, but I applied a solidify modifier. So the solidify modifier is inside of the modifiers tab, and then you just go down to solidify it, and it makes it a bit bigger, apply it, and it essentially just makes more mesh for UEFN to look at, or Unreal Engine to look at. Otherwise, it doesn't show up properly, so you have to have, I don't know exactly how much mesh, but some mesh. Okay, so when you've done that, you just go File, Export, FBX, you're done. That's it. That's all there is to that. So back inside of UEFN, we can just simply drag that object into our content browser. So I've already done that. You literally just drag the FBX into that. I put it inside of my project folder, inside of objects, and inside of here, everything has just arrived, all the materials and the body of the button and the actual button. We're going to redo this one because I've already done this one. All the modeling and stuff like that, dragging objects in is no problem. But what we want to do here, set up the button to look like a different button, and then we're going to make it move. So the first thing we want to do is we want to go into the custom mesh, and then inside of here is going to be the button body. So look at that. Just select that and bam, it shows up. And you can see here how that middle part didn't come through properly. So that needs to be remodeled and figured out. So that's a little bit thicker and works properly. And then the other part, the what I call the plunger, the button part that moves, we're going to drag that in and move it more or less into place here. Actually, probably precisely into place, something like that. I think that's pretty good. Let's move around a little bit and make sure it's reasonably centered. It looks good. We can't see the mesh underneath. Just a little bit there, eh? So let's bring this over just a bit. Take a look on the other side. No, it's too far. So you just get to just sort of mess around a little bit, get that right. Okay, so that is going to be probably the button in position. So we're going to bring it out to what I think should be the out position. And that's about right. Something that makes it look like it's not quite connected. Let's come out to here, yeah, about there. And now we want to make it move. So to do that, we're going to make a sequence. So I have, again, inside of my content folder, I have my objects, my sounds, and inside of here, I put my creative devices. You can make another one called sequences, but all my creative devices, sequences kind of fall in there. So I've got a button sequence here. We're going to make a brand new one. So we're going to right click and we're going to go level sequence. We're going to call this new button sequence. And sequences are really cool. I like to think of these as sort of animation areas. A long time ago, I came from Flash, which was made by a company named Macromedia and then bought up by Adobe, which it was then similarly run into the ground and Flash disappeared. But if we were to think about After Effects or Premiere or something like that, we would just think of this kind of like a composition, an area where we're going to make a thing and then we're going to put it in the other thing. So the new button sequence, we're going to double click that and it's going to open up the sequencer. And the sequencer is where we make our animation. If yours does not look like this, make sure you've got yours set to 30 frames per second or whatever frames per second you choose to. 30, I think, is right. And then we also want to show the time as seconds. You could do it in frames, which can be quite useful. But in our case, we're going to do seconds. We really just want a half a second. So down on the bottom right here, we can set the length 0.5. And then and that'll be it. We just want a half a second animation. We also, because this is off center, we can set this to be centered by just going over here and put zero. And so that'll make this whole sequence from zero to 0.5 of a second, the whole animation. All right, so let's select our plunger and then we'll go track, actor to sequence, add button new to button plunger, which is that object we just selected, to the sequence. Okay, so there it is. So we've added that in. Now we want to transform it. Transform it just means move it. And we want to move the location of the Y because the green arrow is the Y. So we're starting at the very beginning. You can drag the playhead around just by selecting this orange area, bring it all the way back to the beginning. We're going to hit this tiny, tiny little button to add a keyframe, and it's going to add a keyframe for the Y. We're going to go halfway through, 2.3 seconds, and we're going to just move it in like so. So if you drag on this little thing here, it'll actually automatically add that keyframe in. So we don't have to hit the plus button for a keyframe. And we'll go all the way to the end to 0.5. And we'll add in, well, actually what we'll do something neat. We'll select this other keyframe while holding it, hit the Alt key, and then drag all the way over to 0.5. And now check us out. If we play it, it plays the button. So that's really cool. All right, so we're done the animation right now. There's nothing more to do here. We can actually just go ahead and save that and close it. And that gives us our new button sequence. Now, to play our new button sequence, we need a cinematic device, a cinematic sequence player. So we'll go cinematic like that. And cinematic sequence device is right here. Drag that, bring it up so it's kind of visible. Bring it over this way, because this is what's going to play that sequence. So we're going to call this device. And this device is going to say, what do you want me to do? And say, I want you to play this sequence. So with this cinematic sequence device player selected, we can go and select our new button sequence, just like that. And then, so this device will activate this player. Make sense? And then we're also going to add in an audio player. So let's go into devices again inside of Fortnite. We'll go audio player and we'll drag this up. We want this to be the sound of the button. So not only is it going to move, but it's going to make some sound too, because this is a proper button. We want some proper interaction going on. So I'm going to put it right behind the button like that. You can see, because it's spatialized sound, meaning that the sound comes from where it sounds like it should be coming from. So I put it right inside the button right there. And let's set the file for that. So inside of my folder again, I go into my sounds folder. And inside of here is a sound I downloaded off of Artlist. This isn't sponsored, so there you go. We're going to simply just drag this over into the audio attribute of this device. And it should just stick. It should just go in. Now, if you didn't want to do that, you can actually just click the list here and it'll be inside of here. But there's a pile of other sounds too, and you might not be able to find it right away. So it's easy. It's just to drag it over. And this WAV file is just dragged into the content browser. There's nothing special about importing these files. It's very, very easy. The last thing we want to do is link everything up. So to link everything up, we actually need to go into Verse. If you haven't created a Verse file in your game, I've got one called Game Manager. I've done tutorials about how to do this, but essentially this allows us to, this console here allows us to have code run things that are running inside of our scene, our game. So inside of Verse, when we double click Game Manager, we'll get this to pop up. And this is the basics that we've got going on right now. Very simple. I've got a bunch of editable stuff. So ignore these two here. We don't need them. We need these three. So I'll show you how this is coded and we'll take a look at the other one that I did earlier. So what we have is a button device labeled My Push Button. This is just the name that I've called it. Call it whatever you want. It's a button device editable. Another editable for the button sequence. So this is the sequence that plays, that pushes that button in and out. Cinematic sequence device. No problem, right? This editable is for the button sound player. It's the audio player device. So now we can link up these three things in our game to our code through this. You drag the game manager on, it makes one of these doodads. Okay, so now back over to these guys. We can see I've set up, this one's exactly the same. So just to show you, this is our body, our plunger. We've got a cinematic device here and we've got the audio player here, right? So back over to our console, when we click it, we go into the details panel. You can see all of these, but just in case you haven't, you have to build your Verse code before you go any further. Over inside of selecting your game manager device that you've dragged onto the screen, you can put in your push button because they'll just show up inside of here. In fact, we could change it to be the button. We could change this one to be the cinematic sequence device that I haven't renamed. And the sound player can also be the audio player too. So now I've just changed it over to work with the other button, which is this one, right? Yeah, this is the new one. So in theory, this should work, if the code is correct. So let's go take a look at the rest of the code. So since we've got it all linked up now, we've done everything in the scene, done everything to connect these two in code. Now we just need to make things run. So to do that, we want to go into the on begin and we want to listen for, okay, so we want to listen to the button being clicked, which we do with interacted with event. And we subscribe to that and then we call a function on pop. Push button activated, which is right here. And this is the simplest part of it all. We literally just put button sequence play, which will play that sequence that we had for the button to go in and out, and then button sound player play, and it will play the sound. And that's it. You're done. You're all done. That will allow you to push this button. It'll go in and out, play the sound, and then from there you can do something even more. So hopefully this has been helpful and interesting. That ends the whole tutorial. I'll see you guys in the next one.